In this video, we look at two new parts of speech. And the first one is the gerund. A gerund is a verbal noun. In other words, it is part verb and part noun. In English, we translate gerunds with ing. And you'll see that here in this example. Consider the sentence, I like pizza and running. Now, obviously, both of those words are functioning as nouns. But then, you see, I've highlighted the word running here. Run, obviously, is a verb, right? Run is a big action word. But in this sentence, it's functioning the same way that pizza is functioning. I like what? I like pizza. I like what? I like running. In Latin, you'll always be able to recognize a gerund because it has an ND in the middle of the word. And in fact, they will have certain endings as well. So you got the ND in the middle, and then the following forms. There is no nominative gerund. That just doesn't exist, even though it's a verbal noun. And you'll also notice that the singular and plural are the same. That's why I have them in the same column here. And then the genitive gerund will end with NDI, dative NDO, accusative NDUM, and ablative NDO. And again, the key thing is the ND in the middle. And that's really going to be helpful because the word gerund itself has an ND in it. And so that's how you're going to be able to recognize. Well, let's take a look at a sample sentence here. Go ahead and copy this sentence and then circle the gerund and identify its case. As always, pause the video and press play when you're ready to go on. So you should have circled pugnandum. We see the ND in the middle of the word there. And the ending is really NDUM, and so that would make it accusative case. Now take a moment and see if you can translate the sentence. You should have come up with Roman soldiers loved gold and fighting. Gold is obviously a noun, it's a thing. Fight is definitely a verb, but again, in this sentence, it's functioning like a noun. They loved what? They loved fighting. Now, the second part of speech is related, it certainly has a related name. They are the gerundives. And a gerundive is a verbal adjective. It's part verb and part adjective. So where a gerund is part verb, part noun, a gerundive is part verb, part adjective. And a good way to remember that is that the gerundive is an adjective. Now in English, a gerundive is translated to be blank. And this is why another name for the gerundive is the future passive participle. If you think something is to be done, obviously that hasn't happened yet, and that sounds very much like the future. So consider this sentence. The country to be attacked organized its soldiers. Well, we have to be attacked as our gerundive. You could have just as well said the big country organized its soldiers, the rich country organized its soldiers. In this case, it's the to-be-attacked country. Attack is obviously a verb, but the phrase to-be-attacked is functioning like an adjective describing country. Now, in Latin, gerundives, like gerunds, are going to have that N-D in the middle of the word. So really, anytime you see the N-D in the middle, it's going to indicate either a gerund or a gerundive. But here's the key thing about gerundives. They will also end in any first declension ending, if they're feminine, and any second declension ending, if they are masculine or neuter. Since they're adjectives, they have to change gender depending on the noun they modify. And if they're modifying a feminine word, they use first declension endings. If they're modifying masculine or neuter words, they'll use second declension endings. So again, let's take an example. Circle the gerundive in this sentence, draw an arrow to the noun it modifies, and while you're at it, underline the gerund. Again, you're going to want to pause the video and then press play when you're ready to continue. So you should have circled liberandus and underlined expectandum. And you say, well, okay, well, how do I know the difference? Well, they both have an ND, so that tells you that each of those words is one or the other, either gerund or gerundive. Liberandus has the NDUS. That is not one of the gerund endings. In fact, the US is a second declension masculine ending. So it's functioning as the verbal adjective. That's why we drew the arrow from liberandus to modify servus. Expectandum isn't modifying anything. It's the verbal noun. And that might even be something you want to jot in your notes as well. A gerundive has to modify something. A gerund doesn't modify anything. And as before, take a moment and see if you can translate this sentence. And you should have come up with, the slave to be freed did not like waiting. Again, liberandus is the adjective, like what kind of slave? You could have said the tall slave, the Greek slave. In this case, it's the to be freed slave. What did he not like? Well, he did not like waiting. You could just as well have said he did not like dogs. He did not like pizza. Wait is a verb, but here it's functioning as a verbal noun. And that's what gerunds and gerundives are all about.